Speaker, well, I move that so much of the standing orders be suspended as would prevent the Leader of the Opposition from moving the following motion. The House, one, expresses its grave concern at the vicious rise of anti-Semitic vilification in our country and the breakdown in social cohesion occurring in our communities. Two, expresses its grave concern that social disharmony has reached dangerous levels and that community safety is now at significant risk. Three, condemns the Prime Minister's failure to show the strong leadership required to overcome divisions within his own caucus, to stamp out anti-Semitism and bring our country together.
Order, members on my right.
Expresses its concern that community safety in this country has been further threatened by the release of more than 80 hardcore criminals from immigration detention into the Australian community. Five, expresses its deep concern that this cohort includes individuals who have committed acts of child rape, murder, sexual assault and other violent crimes. Six, condemns the government for catastrophically and demonstrably failing to prepare contingencies for High Court proceedings where it was fully aware of the risks. Seven, and condemns the Minister for Immigration, Citizenship and Multicultural Affairs for then undertaking an unprecedented and shocking mass release of dangerous criminal non-citizens into the Australian community. Mr Speaker, the reality is that this Prime Minister has been missing in action. Missing in action when the Australian people need him most. The Australian Prime Minister has one of the most serious charges in this country. That is to take care of the Australian people, to protect, to defend them, to make sure that where threats exist, the Prime Minister utilises the powers at his disposal to deal with that threat, to neutralise it and to keep our country and our people safe. And he fails at the first hurdle. He fails at the first hurdle. The dreadful attacks that we saw on October 7 in Israel resulted in a listed terrorist organisation here in our country and in other countries in the West and other parts of the developed world saw Hamas go in and massacre people of Jewish faith. It was a disgraceful act and rightly condemned by both sides of politics. It has given rise to a discussion here in this country, in the United States, elsewhere in the world, and it has seen a significant rise in anti-Semitic behaviour. And I commend those members, one of them that I can identify on the opposite side, for having the guts to stand up and to speak strongly in favour of the Jewish community against those who perform provocative acts, calling Jews names that shouldn't be repeated anywhere, but F the Jews and gas the Jews. And this Prime Minister had a solemn duty, Mr Speaker,
Attorney
to stand
General
up
was
and
protected.
To make sure that his government spoke with one voice. But did they do that? No. And what the Australian public has seen and what has shocked the Jewish community in recent weeks since the 7th of October is that this government is speaking out of both sides of its mouth. Let's call it out for what it is. You've got Senator Wong in the other place, the foreign minister of this country, who is at odds with her prime minister. The caucus is split right down the middle, and the Australian public sees that this is a government where the wheels are quickly falling off. It's given rise to social disharmony in this country. There are Jewish kids who are afraid to go to school. We've got groups, Mr Speaker, who are going into predominantly Jewish communities in our country to try and provoke them into a response. And this Prime Minister is flying off overseas again when he should be staying in this country to deal with the issue. What could he do, he says? What can he possibly do about it? Well, Prime Minister, I've written to you, and what you should do is consult with the Premiers and the Chief Ministers and immediately convene a meeting of the National Cabinet to get a better understanding of the police response, to understand what the security and intelligence agencies are providing, to collate that information and to have a coherent response which provides support and an underpinning to security for people of Jewish faith in this country when they need it most. In their hour of need, this Prime Minister has gone missing. I never thought that I would see in my lifetime a repeat of the horrific scenes that we saw and that we've read about during the course of the Second World War repeated in our lifetimes, but to see people of Jewish faith cowering in their homes, being dragged from cupboards out into the street, when children are still abducted and still held hostage, this Prime Minister needs to stand up and to be united with the Jewish community, and he's not. The words have been qualified, the message divided, and the Australian public has looked to the Prime Minister and not identified this man compared to the man that they voted for in May of 22, less than 18 months ago. Now, what compounds it, Mr. Speaker, is the fact that in the last 48 hours, we learned that the hapless Minister for Immigration has taken a decision to release 83 hardened criminals, rapists, paedophiles, murderers, the rest of the detail he won't disclose, release those 83 people to live at large in the community with the Australian public, and he's done nothing about it, Mr. Speaker. The government knew that this case was being decided in the High Court. They have the benefit of the advice of the first law officer of this country, the Solicitor General, and countless KCs at their disposal. The High Court had given indications in relation to this matter. A competent minister would have dealt with this matter by way of legislation at the first available opportunity, and he would have rushed that legislation through this parliament so as to prevent the 83 from going out into the community with the significant potential of committing more offences against the Australian public. One charge, as I say, for this Prime Minister, one primary charge to keep the Australian public safe, to keep them safe. There is legislation now being drafted. We saw in a train wreck interview by the Defence Minister, the Deputy Prime Minister this morning, that there is legislation being drafted to address this issue. We hear from Senator Wong in the Senate today that there will be legislation introduced into the parliament. So we know now that when the government's been called out and they're under pressure, there actually is a legislative response available. We now know that. Why is it available now, but it wasn't available before the 83 were released into the community? The minister refuses to answer that question. It turns out that this minister has released these dangerous criminals into the community without a visa. Some of those have been left out, and you saw his evasive, tricky and incompetent responses today. Did the Prime Minister pull him into line? Not a chance, Mr. Speaker. Not a chance, because this Prime Minister is as weak as water, and the Australian public are working out what a fake and a fraud he and his government have turned out to be. Now, the Australian public at the moment know that they have got a government who has made every situation in their lives more difficult. We know that the cost of living pressures are putting enormous pressure on families because the government has made incompetent decisions in two budgets. We now know that in many parts of the country, Australians are suffering because of a crime crisis in their communities. We know that. How does this Prime Minister respond? He goes off overseas again. Prime Minister, don't leave this country until you have dealt with these issues. Don't hop on the plane again to the United States. You've just met with President Biden, an incredibly important relationship, but you've just met with the President. The first responsibility for you, Prime Minister, is to be here and take care of the Australian public. Don't continue to abrogate your responsibilities. How can the government release 83 of the people who have criminal records, significant criminal records, and keep in detention 9 when they are all subject to the same finding from the High Court? How can that be the case? How can you not have legal capacity or legal capability to keep the 83 in, but you do to keep the 9 in? I mean, has this been explained by the Prime Minister? No, it has not, Mr. Speaker. So the Prime Minister should not leave this country until the National Cabinet has been convened to provide assurances and support and comfort and safety to people of the Jewish community. That is the first priority for this Prime Minister, not to get on yet another plane and head overseas. Prime Minister, don't leave Canberra and don't leave this parliament until legislation has been passed which will give effect to providing safety to the Australian people, because what is happening is these people with significant criminal records, having committed significant rapes, and assaults and murders against Australian citizens are being released into the community, and you stand condemned.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Well, when people look for a definition of overreach, they will search for this motion. Let's move by the Leader of the Opposition.
There is no issue too big for him to show how small he is.
We'll cease the objection.
And the weaponisation or attempt to weaponise anti-Semitism in this chamber and make it a partisan issue is frankly beyond contempt. Frankly beyond contempt. I spoke in this chamber on Monday about the events in Caulfield and about the events in the eastern suburbs of Sydney. There was no qualification whatsoever in my condemnation. And I have spoken since to people, including the Israeli ambassador, Gillian Siegel, this morning, Moshe Khan, the rabbi from Balaclava, in the electorate of McNamara, from that community, sent me a message of saying thank you for speaking out so clearly and so unequivocally. So to come in here and move this resolution and link anti-Semitism with the decision of the High Court is beyond contempt. Beyond contempt. This is the same political party that tried to repeal Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act. And I stood with Peter Wertheim and other members of the Jewish community at that time. The Executive Council of the Australian Jury said this: that would be the worst possible message to send at a time of increasing fear, insecurity and polarisation. It would be a serious abrogation of principled leadership by government, and indeed it was, which is why it was defeated. They failed to deliver the religious discrimination bill. They moved in here, and when an amendment was passed to carry anti-vilification provisions, they voted against it and trashed their own legislation before it was passed. I make no apologies for standing up against anti-Semitism, and I will do it unequivocally, as I have, as someone who led a campaign against a council in my own electorate, against the BDS campaign. I think two decades ago. I have a track record on this and I'm proud of it. But I also have a track record of standing up for the rights and for justice of Palestinian people. And I make no apologies for being a consistent supporter of a two-state solution. And I make no apologies for trying to bring communities together, not divide them, because that's the role of political leaders. And at a time when there is social division, leaders have a choice. They have a choice to either bring people together or divide them. Try to look for unity or look for opportunism. And what we have seen from this bloke here is consistent with his entire political career, has been based upon division between
the member for Groom will cease interjecting.
Now, Jewish Australians are fearful at the
moment. O'Connor.
The sort of activity that is occurring is scaring them, and I stand with them. No one should threaten people because of their religion or their race in this country. But it is also the case that Arab Australians and Islamic Australians and women wearing hijabs in the streets of Sydney and Melbourne are being threatened, and I stand against that as well. The idea of selective human rights is one that I stand against. So I'm opposed to any innocent life being lost, whether it be as a result of the terrorism of Hamas in Israel. Those dreadful occasions. Dreadful occasions.
The member for Barker will cease interjecting.
Innocent babies, I'm against being killed in Gaza. We have responsibilities as a democratic nation to say that democratic nations must stand up consistent with the international rule of law. And that is something that I have done and will consistently do. That's something that I will have meetings on in APEC at San Francisco. I stand up for Israel's right to defend itself. I've done that consistently. I also say how it does it matters. And I say that we need to care for all
Order.
Civilians.
It doesn't matter to you then.
It doesn't matter
to Order.
We then have somehow a link between that issue and the issue of the High Court decision. A High Court decision that in the words of the Leader of the Opposition himself, he said this, having been responsible for these issues for 6 years. He went on 2GB yesterday and said, I'm not going to comment on individual cases because in some of those cases I will have been a decision maker. And in relation to that case, I believe that I was.
Order.
So if the matters go to court Order. Again, I don't want to interfere
Order.
Or take that process.
The member for Groom will cease
and he
objecting.
Stood up here.
Members
said,
on my left.
He said that
and
we should have prevented
Bowman.
People from being released, prevented a High Court decision. Having stood in here day after day, week after week, month after month, and said, you've got to respect the Constitution. You can't change the Constitution because if you do, you can't out-legislate it. That's what he said. That's what they all said in Justify.
Order.
They're no vote. Day after day, week after week.
Order.
This is what he said in May in this chamber. The Parliament cannot out-legislate the Constitution. But when it's convenient, we'll just chuck it out and pretend it doesn't exist. They were responsible for a decade, for a
Order.
Decade. The legislation that's been thrown out by the High Court was coalition
Remember
legislation.
For Bowman and Groom
coalition
are now
legislation.
Warned.
And then they say there's no responsibility. No responsibility.
Order.
The opportunism of the Leader of the Opposition has been exposed for all to see here today. But I didn't think that he could go this low as to link these two issues, to try to link these two issues. And then he tries to link it as well, with just to get a go, another crack in the tabloids, or to get a hear from Sky After Dark. He tries to link it with, therefore, we should not be represented at APEC, which has been there for 30 years.
Order.
30 years, where every Prime Minister,
Order.
Every Prime Minister,
Member for Wannan,
since APEC's creation as a leaders' summit,
the member
by
for
Paul
Wannan
Keating,
will cease
has been represented.
Interjecting.
The only time that has not occurred is when Prime Minister Gillard had to return to Australia after a tragedy in her family, so she returned early. John Howard every time coalition prime ministers. But, you know, that's not okay. They do
Order.
That. Well, at the same time, he leads a party who had a shadow ministry meeting almost over there in London, at their talk fest. You know, Taylor, Morrison,
Order.
Price, Pike, Antich, Joyce, Patterson, Tien, Webster, Canavan,
Order.
Hastie.
The Prime Minister will use the correct titles for members.
In an article titled, Tony Abbott and John Howard joined Jordan Peterson-led group looking at meaning of life, it was exposed that they were paid for
Order.
By foreign billionaire hedge fund managers. 12 of them.
Order.
12 of them. The fact is.
Order.
The fact is that one in four of Australian jobs depends upon our trade. I make no apologies for re-engaging and fixing some of the problems that we were left. Fixing some of the problems, which is why we're dealing with supply chain issues, which is why we see trade and the impediments in China being removed, which is why I will meet with President Biden, President Xi, Prime Minister Trudeau, Prime Minister Kishida, and all the meetings that have been scheduled over one day.
Now, the fact is that this motion has been brought forward because
order.
This Leader
the
of the Opposition is incapable of saying
order.
Anything positive.
Prime Minister's time has concluded. Order. Members on my right.